Welcome back, children, to the second part of our revision class of Standard 10, first chapter, The Rise of Nationalism in Europe. Children, till now, whatever points we have covered to understand, or we can say we have studied in our previous part, was in perspective of France. But simultaneously, many things, or we can say many upheavals, had taken place even in other parts of Europe in terms of making of nationalism, as the feelings could be seen spreading in Europe. So what was it? How was it? Because here the challenges were little different as compared to France, and these challenges were the regional states, the regional variations, languages, empire and cultures. Till the mid 18th century, no nation state existed in Europe. We can say the structure in European society had immense diversity. Germany, Italy and Switzerland were divided into kingdoms, duchies and cantons, whose rulers had their autonomous or independent territories. They did not share a collective identity or any common culture. The Habsburg Empire ruled over Austria-Hungary. Now, this Habsburg Empire also included the Alpine regions of Tyrol, Austria, the Sudetenland and Bohemia. In Hungary, half of them spoke Magyar language, while the other half spoke a variety of dialects. The only tie binding these diverse groups together was the common commitment, or we can say a loyalty, towards their emperor. So children, looking at such a vast diversity, to infuse a sentiment of nationalism among the European population was one of the biggest challenges. Then how did the idea of nationalism and nation-state emerge? Now, earlier the European society consisted of two groups, that is the aristocracy and the peasantry. Now, who were these aristocrats? They were the high-class landlords. They were numerically a small group, or we can say less in population in the European society. But they were socially and politically a dominant class on the continent, and their families were often connected by the marriages. Okay, now who were these peasantries? The peasantries were the farmers, or we can say the peasants. Now they were the low class landless laborers working for the feudal lords or these aristocrats. Okay, they were more in population, clear, in the European society. I hope children you remember the pyramid structure that you have studied in the French Revolution, right? The noble lords, that is your kings and all, and the clergies, and then the vast population of the peasants and the farmers, right? So they were the more in population, clear, right children? Okay, now they had no rights at all, because the rights were all concentrated with the aristocrats. Clear children? Now industrialization began in England, clear, in the second half of the 18th century. But in France and some parts of the German states, it occurred only during the 19th century. In its wake, when new social groups came into being, and that is the new middle class. Understand, children? Now they are also called as the working class population, made up of industrialists, then businessmen, then the professionals like the doctors, teachers, and so on. Right? It was among these educated and the liberal middle classes that the ideas of national unity following the abolition of aristocrat privileges gained popularity, because they demanded for individual freedom, they demanded for equality before law, and also government by consent. Now, individual freedom means everyone, every individual should have a freedom, right? And equality before law, because no privileges, no birth privileges should be there. Everyone should be treated equally before law. And the government consent, government by consent means government should be elected through the people. And or we can say parliament through the democracy. Clear? Parliament should be formed through the democracy. So what were their ideas towards? It was towards, we can say, liberal nationalism. Now, as a result of all these things, the conflict between the aristocrats and the new middle class started in terms of ideological, political, and social ideas. And all this led to the development of liberal nationalism. Am I clear, children? Now we have to understand what is meant by, or what does liberal nationalism stand for? Yes, children, what does liberal nationalism stand for? The Latin root word of liber means free. That is freedom for individual and equality for all. Right? Now again it is divided between two, or we can say, we can explain in two terms, that is political liberalism and economic liberalism. Now political liberalism, as I said earlier, government by consent. Right, children? Now if you see here how it should be government by consent, a constitution and a representative government through parliament, right? Right to vote and get elected was exclusively given only to the people who owned property, or given only to the men who owned only the property, right? Whereas men without property and women were excluded from any kind of political rights. As a result of that, women and non-property men, that is men who were not owning any property, and all women, right, they organized an opposition movements demanding equal political rights. Am I clear, children? And this was political liberalism, right? Equality for all in terms of political liberalism. And the next is economic liberalization, which means freedom from market and the state imposed restrictions. Children, that is to abolish the state imposed restrictions on the movements of the goods and capital. When a merchant traveled, he had to, during the period of 1833, when he had to travel from Hamburg to Nuremberg to sell his goods, he would have to pass through 11 custom barriers and had to pay the custom duties of about 5% of at each one of the custom barriers. Also, there were obstacles to economic exchanges and the growth by the new commercial classes, who argued for the creation of the unified economic territory along with the unhindered movement of goods, people and capital. So there was a need for a new system, and Zollverein was formed, and that was a custom union which was formed in Prussia, and it was introduced in the year 1834. In which year, children? 1834. What was this custom union? It was Zollverein. Right, children? It was Zollverein. Don't forget this. Custom union imposed in the year 1834, and that was Zollverein. Right, children? And it abolished the tariff barriers. Clear? Which the merchants, they had to pay in the 11 custom barriers. Remember, they had to pay all that 5%. Right? So, it was abolished. And also reduced the number of currencies that they had paid, or they were paying, right? It was reduced from 30 to 2. Clear, children, now? Now, that was the economic liberalization. Now, we will see the next topic, that is a new conservatism after 1815. How conservative regime came back to the power after 1815. Children, till 1815, Napoleon ruled, but he was defeated in the Battle of Waterloo by the four countries. Children, do you remember which were those four countries? They were BRAP. The code we had used. Which were those countries? They were Britain, Russia, Austria and Prussia. Yes. Now, they all believed in conservative ideologies. Right, children? They believed in the monarchical rules. So, now what will be the impact? It is very obvious that the conservatives have become more strong. So, the European governments were driven out by a spirit of the conservatism. Now, who came to the power here? It is none other than the conservatives, or we can say the autocracies, or we can say the monarchy was restored. Right, children? Yes. Who were these conservatives? They were the believers of political philosophy that stressed on the importance of tradition and established institutions based on customs and preferred gradual development, but not a quick change. Understand, children? They needed changes in the society, but it should be a gradual changes in the society and not a quick change in the society, because gradual change may not affect their rule, but a quick change may affect their rule. Right, children? And that was what happened right before 1815. But after Napoleon's defeat, that is after 1815, that is the reason why they brought back conservatism, because they believed in bringing changes in the society, but they wanted a gradual changes, slow changes in the society, but not a quick change in the society. But most of the conservatives did not propose a return to the society of pre-revolutionary days. Pre-revolutionary days, that is before the Napoleon's period, the olden days. Because now, according to them, modernization that had already come to the society could strengthen the traditional institutions. Which were the traditional institutions? The monarchy, yes. Because these modernization that was brought by Napoleon, by the Civil Code of 1804, right? Modern army, an efficient bureaucracy, a dynamic economy, the abolition of feudalism and serfdom, all this could strengthen the autocratic monarchies of Europe. And now, in the year 1815, the representatives of the European powers, that is Britain, Russia, Austria, and Prussia, who had collectively defeated Napoleon, they all met at Vienna to draw a settlement for Europe. Now, what was that settlement? We will see that now. Duke Metternich, an Austrian chancellor, he had hosted the Congress that was held at Vienna in the year 1815, and he was called as the chief architect of the Treaty of Vienna. Understand, children? Who was called as the chief architect of the Treaty of Vienna? It was Duke Metternich, right? Right, children? Duke Metternich, right? We will see about him little more afterwards, right? We will see some statements which is given by him related to some people and all those things, right? Now, he was an Austrian chancellor. Children, listen to the points carefully. He was an Austrian chancellor who had hosted the Congress that was held at Vienna in the year 1815. And therefore, he was called as the chief architect of the Treaty of Vienna. Clear, children? Now, as per the Treaty of the Vienna, the Bourbon dynasty, which had been overthrown by Napoleon during the French Revolution, was restored to power. Right? And France had lost the territories that had been annexed under Napoleon. The German Confederation of 39 states that had been set up by Napoleon was left untouched. Yes, children, clear with that? Okay, then the new boundaries of states were set up around France, like the Kingdom of Netherlands was set up in the north, and Geneva was added in Piedmont in the south. Prussia was given new territories on its western frontiers. Then Austria was given a control of northern Italy, and Russia was given a part of Poland, and Prussia was given a part of Saxony. I hope, children, it is very clear to you all. This is how the monarchies that had been overthrown by Napoleon were restored and had created a conservative regime in Europe. Not only all these changes took place, but the autocrats did not even tolerate the criticism and dissents, and decided to curb the activities that questioned the legitimacy of autocratic government. So, what was that problem that the autocrats or the conservatives had to face? The problems that they faced, that the conservatives faced, were the revolutionaries now. Because the revolutionaries wanted to overthrow the conservatives, and they were strongly supported by the nationalists and the liberalists in the society, in the European society. I hope, children, you still remember these people in the society, in the European society, the liberals, the nationalists, the democrats, radicals, the conservatives, that you have already studied in class 9 when you had studied the French Revolution. Right, children? Yes. So these revolutionaries who were against the conservatives, they started getting support from the nationalists and the liberalists now. During the years following 1815, the fear of repression drove many liberals and nationalists underground. Revolutionary at that time meant a commitment to oppose monarchical forms, to fight for liberty and freedom. One such revolutionist was Giuseppe Mazzini. Now, here, this is the image of Giuseppe Mazzini. Now, he was born in the year 1807 in Geneva. Right? Where was he born? In Geneva in the year 1807. He became a member of a secret society of Carbonari. Right? As a result of which, he was sent into exile. Right? In the year 1831. For attempting a revolution in Liguria. Where was he sent? He was sent to Liguria. For what purpose? For attempting a revolution in the year 1831. Clear, children? Then he founded two secret societies like Young Italy in Marseilles and Young Europe in Bern. Right? Now he believed that God had intended nations to be the natural units of mankind. Now, secret societies were also set up in Germany, France, Switzerland, and also in Poland. And do you know, children, they were joined by the like-minded people, like-minded young men. Clear? Now, when I had introduced Duke Metternich, I had told you that there will be some statements given by him. Now, here one of the statements given by Duke Metternich for describing Giuseppe Mazzini was, described him as the most dangerous enemy of our social order. Because like him, there were many revolutionaries who were striving for independence against the conservatives or against the monarchical orders. I hope, children, all the points are clear till now. Now, the next topic is the age of revolution between the period 1830 and 1848. Now, as I said earlier, children, the liberalists and the nationalists were associated with the revolution because they wanted political and economic liberalism in many regions of Europe, like Italian and German states, the provinces of Ottoman Empire, Ireland and Poland, right? But the first upheaval that took place was in France in July 1830, wherein the Bourbon king, who had been restored to the power during the conservative regime after the 1815, were now overthrown by the liberal revolutionaries. Now, looking at this, Duke Metternich, he once remarked that when the France sneezes, the rest of the Europe catches cold, because such revolutions or the reforms always were observed first in France and was followed by the rest of European countries. Though the Bourbon dynasty was restored after the Treaty of Vienna, but now it was only a constitutional monarchy, understand, right? Whose power was limited by the constitution. So after France got independence on July 1830, Belgium was also freed from the United Kingdom of Netherlands due to the people's protest against the Kingdom of Netherlands, right? Then the Greek War of Independence took place against the Ottoman Turks, right? Where Greek was declared as an independent country or independent nation after the Treaty of Constantinople was signed in the year 1832, right? Greek was declared as independent after the Treaty of Constantinople in the year 1832. Right, children? Now, Greece was also said to be the cradle of Europe because of its ancient civilization in Europe. It was considered to be a very old civilization in Europe. Clear? Now, Greek War of Independence became another event which mobilized nationalism feeling among the educated people in Europe. Now, Lord Byron, who was an English poet, also participated in the Greek War of Independence. He collected funds and fought in the war also, and died in the war due to fever. Clear, children? I hope, children, all the topics covered in this video has cleared all your doubts till now. Go through the videos very carefully and all the parts will help you to memorize the points for your exam. Read the chapter thoroughly, and in the next video we will continue with the chapter with the remaining topics. Till then, children, take good care of your health and bye.